Welcome to Building Bridges in the Community. My name is Kat Hassan-West, and I'm your host for today's program, which is produced by the ARC of Montgomery, Berks, and Bucks County. Today we are going to discuss adult protective services. Joining us is the House of Representatives, Representative Thomas Mert, and Steve Sarovic, who's the Executive Director of the ARC of Pennsylvania. Welcome, gentlemen. Steve, can we begin maybe with you on telling our viewers what prompted the advocacy that was done to get the legislature to pass an adult protective services law?
Sure. The ARC, along with a number of other disability organizations, have for years often received phone calls from people who either friends or family members who have been abused or they believe are being abused, neglected, or exploited in some way. And for years, the organizations such as the ARC have received these calls, but there's often been very little we could do. For example, there's a child protective services law in Pennsylvania and an older adult protective services law in Pennsylvania. So if a child up to age 17 is being abused or neglected, there is a system in place that can receive the report and an investigation can be authorized to go out to see if the individual is actually being abused or not. And those laws that for child protective services and older adult protective services authorize local officials to go in and investigate and then protect the child or older adult. For many years, up until just this past fall, when our law was passed, Pennsylvania had no similar law for people ages 18 to 59. And so advocacy groups like the ARC of Montgomery, Berks, and Bucks and the ARC of Pennsylvania and other organizations representing people with physical disabilities, for example, would receive these phone calls and would try to let authorities, government authorities, know about them, but there was often little that they could do. For example, there could be a situation where you believe your neighbor is being abused, who's an adult, maybe being abused by a friend or a family member or even a parent. And if you call the police might be able to show up and knock on the door, but they wouldn't have any authority to necessarily enter that home if the parent or the person suspected of abusing the person did not want to let them in. So there was really no law that authorized local officials to enter homes and investigate situations that were alleged. And so organizations did begin to advocate with the General Assembly many, many years ago. In fact, in 2003, there was a report commissioned by the Pennsylvania Legislative Budget and Finance Committee to examine the issue and study other states to see how they handled these situations. And what that report, when it was published, what it revealed was that almost every state other than about five or six states had an adult protective services law. Pennsylvania didn't. And what it also learned was that it would not necessarily break the bank to have one. It estimated that it would cost about $6 million. And it also estimated that annually, if there was such a protective services system in place in Pennsylvania, about 4,000 reports of suspected abuse would occur, of which about 30% or 1,200 would be substantiated. So in 2003, we knew from this report that up to 1,200 or even more individuals were being abused, and there was no law or system in place to protect them. So the ARC, other organizations, the MS Society, the Independent Living Community, United Cerebral Palsy, a number of other organizations got together and we formed a coalition and we started advocating with the General Assembly to get a bill introduced and passed. It took some time. That's not uncommon for pieces of legislation. It does take time to get laws passed. But with the help of the prime sponsor, Senator Pat Vance from Cumberland County, Representative Matt Baker, Representative Babette Josephs, and with friends like Representative Mert, who is the chair of the Intellectual Disability Caucus in the legislature, we were finally able to get the bill passed in the fall and signed by the governor.
I see. Steve, you mentioned that other states had this type of service. Did Pennsylvania take a look at what the other states were doing when they put together the adult protective services?
Yes, we did, and that was something that the report also looked at. The people that conducted their study, they looked at other states, and every state is a little different. Other states had provisions of older adult protective services laws that would cover the adults 18 to 59. Other states had freestanding laws. So Pennsylvania did look at how other states conducted this, and it was based on that experience experience with how much things would cost and how many reports would be made and substantiated. That informed the report, and that report really did inform the legislation and the legislative process to get our adult protective services law passed.
I see. Could you maybe elaborate a little bit on what the adult protective services would actually do for the adults who are being abused or neglected?
Sure. The law, in simplest form, the law basically provides a place for people who suspect abuse and neglect to make a report. Right now, there's a maze of organizations and agencies that one might call, and they might be lucky enough to have the agency be able to go out and do something. Under this law, there will be local protective services agencies identified through a bidding process with the state. They will set up regionally, and it will be a place where people who suspect abuse and neglect and exploitation, where they can go to make the report. Once that report is made, the law will then authorize those local officials to go out and conduct an investigation. Right now, there is no such authority. So once that report is received by a local protective services agency, they will then be authorized to go out and investigate. And that means entering a home if necessary and appropriate. That means being able to remove the individual from a potentially harmful, dangerous situation and put them in a safer place with appropriate supports and services while the investigation is going on. So again, the law really sets up an infrastructure, it gives a place for people to call, and it also authorizes investigations and authorizes the removal of a person if a situation is revealed to be bad and harmful and abusive.
I see. Representative Mert, may I ask you about the Pennsylvania Premise Alert System?
Certainly, Kat. I want to mention we've been talking about abuse and neglect of adults with intellectual disabilities, but I think it's important to mention that this abuse and this neglect manifests itself in many, many ways, and it's some of the stories and the accounts are extremely painful to read and to become aware of. And there are many ways in which some of our constituents and neighbors are being abused and neglected. Some we find are being abused physically, some are being abused financially, where their Social Security disability is being taken from them and not being used for clothing and necessities and food and so forth. Some of these individuals are being abused sexually, and some are being abused emotionally. And unfortunately, what we have seen is that the caregivers involved are actually preventing the authorities from actually helping the person for whom they are supposed to be responsible. And some of these accounts are, as I mentioned, very, very painful to read about and to meet some of the players. Kat, you asked about the Pennsylvania Premise Alert System, and this program is extremely important. And what we have found amongst our law enforcement professionals is that frequently when a police officer will be called out to a home or to a household where there might be an adult with special needs or some sort of intellectual disability, perhaps autism or another disability, Sometimes our police officers are not aware of this particular situation, and an individual may not be able to communicate effectively. An individual may not be acting in a rational manner, and sometimes the police officers are not aware of all the disabilities involved, and may not handle the situation in the best manner. And the Pennsylvania Premise Alert System is a system through which a family who has an adult member with special needs can contact the police office or the local municipality ahead of time and provide information for a police officer. So if there is a call, and if a police officer has to visit that home or that household, they know, because it's in the database, that there is an adult there with special needs who may have an emotional disorder or an intellectual disability of some sort, and it empowers the police officers to respond in the most appropriate fashion. In this regard, knowledge and information is powerful, because our police officers always want to know what kind of situation they are going to encounter when they make a call to a home, or when they answer a call. And in that particular situation, the premise alert system allows our police officers to have a better idea of what the situation is when they answer a call.
I see. Can I ask you, just kind of adding to what you just said, what type of training is going on right now with the police departments? If an individual is, say, nonverbal and they sign, they use sign language for communication, Is the police department being trained on how to communicate with individuals with special needs, or do they just see this individual has autism, but they don't quite understand the behavioral and the communications involved with someone who might be nonverbal with an autism diagnosis?
Kat, that is an excellent question, and the answer is every police officer that is certified and trained in Pennsylvania does receive some training in dealing with individuals with intellectual disabilities and individuals with special needs. And this is a good example of how our police training has evolved, has become more professional over the years. So we believe this type of training is critically important. So as I mentioned, when a police officer answers a call to a home where there is an adult with an intellectual disability, that they will handle it professionally and with compassion and with understanding.
I see. And this, the premise alert system, there's not an age requirement. Younger individuals can also be part of the system?
That's correct. And of course, with technology and computers, this is part of the database. And there is a form to fill out. And the form is provided by way of case managers through the Department of Mental Retardation in the Department of Mental Health, and a family is asked to document the various conditions of the individual. So when a police officer receives a call, they will receive that cautionary information by way of the radio or by way of the computer in their police vehicle, that they are responding to a home where there is an individual who might be nonverbal or may have another type of disability of which the police officer should be aware.
I see. Steve, can I ask you, when does this law go into effect, and what sort of challenges are we facing with this law in getting it fully implemented?
The Protective Services law, which for those who want to learn more about it on the internet, it's Act 70. So if you Google Act 70 in Pennsylvania in 2010, you'll get all kinds of information about it. This law goes into effect on April 7th of this year. So it was passed October 7th, and it was to take effect 6 months after passage and signature by the governor. So within about a month and a half, the law takes effect. Now, I want to make sure that the viewers understand that the law was passed without funding attached to it. And some of that was understandable because laws such as this do take time to get up and running. So, for example, this particular Protective Services law does require regulations to be developed and promulgated. And anyone who's familiar with Harrisburg knows that it sometimes takes years to get regulations through the process. Another thing that the state will have to do is develop and issue requests for proposals and have agencies bid on them. This is a bidding, a competitive bidding process. And so once those agencies are selected, they will then have to get up and running, staffed up, trained, and get the infrastructure ready to then receive and reports and investigate them. So there's going to be some time taken to get this done, and that's partly why there was no funding attached to the law when it was passed, because a lot of the activities that need to take place don't cost anything. However, at some point, this system will require funding, and given the budget challenges of the state right now, advocates are a little nervous about when and if this system is going to be fully funded. In the meantime, you asked about challenges and barriers. There will be that April 7th date when the law becomes effective. And if someone makes a call to the Pennsylvania Department of Public Welfare, which is the state agency that's responsible for implementation, I can't tell you whether or not they will be prepared to receive those calls and to act on them. So right now, from an advocate's perspective, we are very aware and conscious of the barriers relative to the funding and the timing of getting regulations and agencies in place. And we want to make it very clear that if a person suspects abuse on April 7th and they call the Department of Public Welfare, they may or may not have a positive experience on the other end of the phone. So that's just the reality of how state government works.
Okay. Thank you, Steve. Berks County, we're going to take a short break and be right back.
You're watching The Arc, Building Bridges in the Community on bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other information on local issues, go to bctv.org.
Hi, welcome back. My name is Kat Hassan-West, and you are watching Building Bridges in the Community, which is produced by the ARC of Montgomery, Berks, and Bucks County. The mission of the ARC is to provide information and resources to individuals with developmental disabilities so that they become more fully independent, self-sufficient, and contributing members of our community. Today we have House Representative Thomas Mert and Steve Sorovic, who is the Executive Director of the ARC of Pennsylvania. And we were talking about adult protective services. Steve was just right now talking a little bit about the challenges on getting this new bill implemented. Mm-hmm. Did you want to talk any more on that, Steve?
Or? No, just, again, I don't want to be repetitive, but Act 70 will take effect on April 7th. And at that time, the State Department of Public Welfare will be authorized in law to actually receive a report and investigate and to protect people. It'll be far from fully operational at that point. I cannot speak for the Department of Public Welfare. I know they're aware that obviously that they have to do a lot to implement this law, and I just want to make sure that the viewers have reasonable expectations that should April 7th come around and you suspect a situation where someone's being abused, whether it's your neighbor or a family member, and you make that call, DPW may or may not be prepared to act on it, but they will be authorized to protect that person if the situation is egregious enough.
I see. In Berks County, if you do have a situation and as of April 7th you're not able to get through, you can always call the Office of Aging at 610-478-6500 or the Department of MHMR at 610-478-3271. Now, this new protective services law is intended to protect vulnerable individuals who are being abused or neglected. But what kind of things are contributing to this abuse and neglect of these people with disabilities? Steve?
I think there's always going to be people out there who do bad things to other people and take advantage of other people. So to some extent, I think we're always going to be faced with that situation, and I'm really happy that we now have Act 70 in place to protect people. You asked a question about what's contributing to that. right now in Pennsylvania, the community-based service system that does exist to serve people with physical and intellectual and other developmental disabilities, the system is in place, but every year it seems like it's underfunded, and it's evidenced by the fact that there are long waiting lists for services. So if you look at the people who have an emergency need, the state keeps track of people who have emergency needs, and there's over 3,000 people statewide right now who have an emergency need. There's another 8,000 plus statewide that has a critical need, and these are the state's own numbers. When parents and friends and siblings are taking care of individuals with disabilities and are caring for them, and they're doing so without any support from the public sector, things become challenging, and sometimes even the parents, their situation, their physical situation deteriorates, and it becomes stressful and challenging. I think the fact that we have a situation in Pennsylvania where people are waiting and people are doing more on their own without any public support can create stress and create situations where abuse and neglect and exploitation, financial exploitation, is going to increase. And so I consider serving people with intellectual disabilities as a core responsibility of state government. And right now, I think with the system being underfunded and long waiting lists existing, I think that creates an atmosphere where abuse and neglect and exploitation does increase.
I see. Representative Mert, did you have something to add to that?
I did want to add, Kat, that Steve makes a very good point. There are families within our Commonwealth, within our communities, where there are parents who are 85 or 86 years old, sometimes older, who care for an adult child with special needs at home. And the adult child with special needs might be 60 or 65 years old. And the parents have always cared at home for their son or daughter, and they probably always will as long as they can. However, a senior citizen who is 85 or 86 years old sometimes suffers various age-related illnesses, arthritis, heart problems, kidney problems, and so forth. The parent is having health care-related problems. Their son or daughter with special needs is having health care-related problems. And this is a very, very serious issue. And as Steve mentioned, there are over 3,000 people on the emergency waiting list across Pennsylvania. And sadly, some of these families will not get help unless one of the parents dies. And as Steve said, this is absolutely a core responsibility of government. And the situation in which we find ourselves with this is a system which is not funded properly and is stretched dangerously thin. And we have found in the past at places like Pennhurst that a facility or a system that is not funded and not staffed and not supervised properly, all kinds of bad things can happen. So this is absolutely, as Steve mentioned, a core responsibility and a moral responsibility of government.
I see. Thank you, Representative Mert. Actually, Representative Mert, we know you're extremely active in supporting individuals with special needs. What work have you done with the Adult Protective Services Coalition?
Kat, I met some advocates out in Harrisburg when I was first sworn in. I was elected in 2006, and I was first sworn in January 2007. And shortly thereafter, I had met some advocates and some individuals from the Acquired Brain Injury Network, the Disability Rights Network, the Waiting List Organization, and of course, ARC. And when they explained their mission, it was very difficult not to feel empathy and not to become passionate about helping adults with special needs. And this is something that if somebody ever asked me what the most important issue to me is, for me personally, this is it. This is the most important issue. And I really feel that every generation of Americans has an issue, be it the environment or whatever. And I really think the challenge for the current generation is taking care of adults with special needs. And I have had many parents in our district and across Pennsylvania who have shared stories, sometimes very sad ones, about caring for their children who have special needs. And we have also had disability expos in our district. We're hosting one in April down in Hatboro. And we are hopeful to have a lot of providers and caregivers come out, as well as family members. We're having an awareness walk that day as well. And we think that's a very good way to serve that population.
I see. Are you able to tell us about your bill entitled Individuals with Intellectual and Developmental Disabilities Bill of Rights Act?
I will be reintroducing this legislation, the Disabilities Bill of Rights Act, in the current session, Kat. And this is an important piece of legislation because it recognizes that individuals with intellectual and developmental disabilities have the right to participate fully in the community and to help make decisions about their own futures, their living situations, their health care, and so forth. And this legislation recognizes that and will enter in statute the rights that individuals with disabilities have. And I really think that Pennsylvania is way ahead of the curve on this one.
I see. I guess for both of you or anyone, as far as if someone is being abused or you suspect someone's being abused, what should they do? Steve?
Well, you mentioned it earlier. I think there's a couple options locally. You can try the Office of Aging, the Berks County Aging Office, or if it's a child, you can always call the County Child Protective Services Office, Child Welfare Office. If it's an adult, you are still going to probably run into a challenge until the law is fully operational. And so what I would do is one of two numbers. One is call the Disability Rights Network of Pennsylvania. They are a federally sanctioned agency in Harrisburg. They have offices regionally in the state. Call the Disability Rights Network of Pennsylvania. Their number is 1-800-692-7443. And when all else fails, after April 7th, the Department of Public Welfare in Harrisburg will be responsible for implementation of this law, and their phone number is 717-787-2600. And other than that, I hope after April 7th, the law will be fully operational, but I think the viewers ought to have their expectations managed until sometime after that.
I want to thank you both for joining us, and I want to thank you, Berks County, for tuning in. You can always reach more information on individuals with disabilities by contacting the ARC at 610-265-4700. Thank you.